Back in February of 2003, the Game Boy Advance SP was released, and it was an awesome update to the original Game Boy Advance model. It had a clamshell design that future Nintendo handhelds still use to this day, which made it easier to carry around in your pocket or backpack or whatever compared to the slender, kinda bulky original Game Boy Advance. It was faster and more powerful than the original model, and finally you were able to play games without adjusting to a light source, as this new model came with a backlit screen, a godsend to kids that play games in dimly lit areas. I remember owning the Game Boy Advance and I had that weird light apparatus that you clip on the top of the Advance just to be able to play games in the dark. And it sucked because while it did work, it kind of felt awkward to lay down and you still kind of had to adjust your sight in various games with dim backgrounds. The games that came out for the Game Boy Advance were some of the most fun and entertaining games I had ever played when I was younger. I still have my original copies of games I got when I was younger, like Mega Man Battle Network Blue Moon, Lady Sai, a game that for all these years I've never been able to seem to misplace for some odd reason. Gunstar Superheroes, the Pac-Man Collection, yes, this is the game. I even have a copy of the same game, but where or who I got it from, I can't remember. Hell, I even still have my old Fairly Odd Parents Game Boy Advance video card. Jesus, look at this fucking potato quality graphics and audio. It's like watching an early YouTube video. It also had the awesome ability to play Game Boy Color games. The Advance being compatible with Game Boy Color games made this console even more of a blast, because now you could go back to Pokemon Crystal or Yellow and play your old save files on a backlit screen. Some games I wish I still had, but I either lost or misplaced them, which sucks because some of these games I played a lot of. Like Pokemon Ruby with the sick ruby red look of the cart, Advanced Wars, Mario Party Advance, Dragon Ball Z Boo's Fury, Yu-Gi-Oh! The Sacred Cards, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater, which was my friend's and I lost like an idiot, Castlevania Aria of Sorrow, and Max Payne. Yeah, I had Max Payne and it was also on the Game Boy. Who would have thought that that would work? Well, it was still fun to play. That's some nostalgia right there. This sound is almost as good as the old PS1 startup mode. Almost. Nah, not really, but it's still nostalgic as all hell. For being a smaller handheld console, this little beast had some pretty impressive graphics and sound. Some games even pushing the limit of what the Game Boy's hardware could do. Like Tony Hawk and Max Payne having fully modeled characters and locations in Tony Hawk's case, and games like Kingdom Hearts Chain of Memories having fully rendered cutscenes. Even the Need for Speed Porsche Unleashed game had some okay looking 3D models and sounds. You could even drive in first person if you wanted to. Let's check out some of my old games on a trip down nostalgia lane. First up is the Pac-Man Collection. The amount of fun me, my sister, and my mom had playing the original Pac-Man, Pac-Man Arrangement, and the fun 3D Pac-Mania. The updated sounds and cartoony graphics on Pac-Man Arranged with appearances from the old gang, Inky, Blinky,
Nigga, I'm pink.
Clyde, and added pervert, Kinky. Why does he have glasses? The old school Pac-Man that can be played in either full screen or the classic scroll mode, which is more easier on the eyes because the full screen mode is pretty small. And on an already small Game Boy Advance screen, that's no good. The added bonus of playing Pack Attack, a Pac-Man themed Tetris game, was also cool. Another reason for my mom to hog the Game Boy. Being able to play Pac-Man and Tetris in the same game, yay. And the pretty cool Pac-Mania in fully rendered 3D graphics on Pac-Man and the gang in an isometric remake of the original levels. Awesome looking and just fun as hell to play. You could even jump in it, a real game changer. Being able to jump over ghosts that trap you or surround you was a nice addition to the gameplay. One that didn't really feel out of place, at least to me.
Pac-Man.
AKA Young Reezy doing the Godzilla Big Head All-Star Weekend. Ooh, no wonder they ride his nuts so hard. Seems like Yao Ming wants some too. Get your bitch ass out the way, nigga.
Ah, shit, here we go. Gunstar Superheroes. The sequel to the Sega Genesis game from back in late 1993, the story takes place after the two noble Gunstar heroes defeated the Destructor, Golden Silver, from the first game. And a Genesis happened that spawned four moons that orbit the Earth, creating a peace that lasts for a good few years. Suddenly, a fifth moon appears and is threatening to resurrect the Empire from long ago, as well as bring back Gold and Silver, after discovering the Megalith to lay destruction across the moons and Earth, controlling the world for the Empire. The protagonists are Red and Blue, named after the old heroes from the first game, and are tasked by the Third Eye organization, with help from Pilot and Companion Yellow, to combat against the Empire, find the four mystical treasure gems, and stop the Empire. But enough about the story, let's jump into the hectic and fast-paced action of the new Gunstar heroes. I always chose Blue in my playthrough, so let's go with Red this time. The first female Gunstar hero in the series. Hell yeah. Shooting up baddies, knifing them like Metal Slug, different gun power-ups at your disposal like explosive rounds, tracers, and rapid fire. So sick. The levels are pretty nice and varied, some missions having you pilot a helicopter and bombing enemies, to riding on top of Yellow's ship, even having a 2.5 dimensional feel while in these missions, and shooting at enemies coming from the background towards the foreground. Real cool. Alright, one more game, and this one was one of my personal favorite Game Boy games. Kingdom Hearts Chain of Memories. Man, this one theme song takes me back. Back to when I first saw the TV ads for Kingdom Hearts on the PS2, remembering the amount of fun I had with the game, as convoluted as the story is, and listening to all that kick-ass music from Yoko Shimomura and Yutara Hikaru. I remember waiting with anticipation for the sequel, and luckily I had something to pass the time by with. The events leading up to the next game. Chain of Memories. Damn, I haven't even passed the main title screen. Alright, let's get into it. Like I said before, the fact that this game opens with a fully rendered 3D cutscene showing Sora, Donald, and Goofy, minus dialogue, was pretty crazy to see in a smaller, less powerful console like the Game Boy compared to its bigger brothers in competition. After watching the cutscene and going into a strange, castle-like structure because of you and your party's Link's subconscious to find King Mickey, yeah. You start playing the game proper, and realize that this game is unlike any of the other Kingdom Hearts games before or since. The combat is mostly made up of cards you get from defeating enemies and bosses. Each card has a number that is basically its power. The higher the number, the better. Enemies attack using cards as well, so there are moments where you'll take hits due to an enemy having a higher value card than yours, or that fucking zero card that breaks anything, even high combos. And yes, you can perform all your old attack combos. Like the standard 3-hit combo by just using 3 attack cards in a row without being interrupted by the enemy cards or card breaks, or more damaging combos with the card slide system, allowing you to perform Strike Raid, Sliding Dash, and more of Sora's old combos from the first game. Also new is the way rooms work. Once you reach a door, it'll either have a number, a color, or need a certain type of card to open. Rooms with numbers on them can be opened by using a card in your deck that's equal to or greater than the number on the door, and depending on which type of card you use, it'll change the room's properties, your deck's properties, or you can make a save room or treasure room. It's always fun to abuse the Teeming Darkness card with high values for easy leveling up early on. Great game, surprisingly fun and challenging if you don't know what to do. And that's that. The Game Boy Advance, the SP, the Micro, even though I only knew one kid who had that small piece of shit in my elementary school, had some great games that many still love and praise to this day. Many people think Advanced Wars was the best game on it with its turn-based war simulation. To Castlevania Aria of Sorrow being many people's favorite Castlevania game, even over Symphony of the Night. My favorite personal Yu-Gi-Oh! Game was on the Game Boy, Sacred Cards. And one of my all-time favorite video games had a port on it in the form of Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past, and Four Swords. Hell, even my two personal favorite Mario games came as ports. Mario Bros. 3 and Super Mario World, all in clean, pristine, updated graphics. This baby still holds a place in my heart after all these years. It never seems to die out or lose its popularity, which is awesome. Mods for the PSP and hacks for the newer generations of consoles still have the ability to add SNES, NES, or Game Boy games to your systems, because people love the games that came with those systems, never giving up on their love for the classics, new or old. This has been JoJo from JoJo Hernandez Games and Album Reviews and Such. Hope you have a good day, and as always, peace and game on.